So for me, as I was saying before, these two lesion, elbow dislocation and medial epicondyle fracture, goes together. As every time you see an elbow dislocation, you have to search for an associated medial epicondyle fracture. On the other hand, every time you see a child who sustained a medial epicondyle fracture, you have to investigate if he had an associated elbow dislocation. We will see later in the talk, these two lesions can be associated in up to 50% of cases. So when you look at the anatomical classification of elbow dislocation, there are multiple options, but the most common one is the posterior or the posteromedial, as you can see in this slide. The anterior form is much more infrequent. However, when you have an anterior elbow dislocation, you have to search after the reduction in a very worrisome complication, which is the compartment syndrome, because compartment syndrome is mostly associated with anterior elbow dislocation. And here a simple example of an isolated dislocation. So what are the principle of treatment? The principle of treatment, of course, are to obtain a concentric reduction. You want to treat any associated injury. You want to restore a good range of motion. And of course, you want to avoid mid to long term elbow instability. So reduction is usually closed and followed by a period of immobilization, 2 to 3 weeks usually, with the elbow flex at 90 to 100 degrees, and no sports for about 6 weeks. Keep in mind that once you reduce an elbow dislocation, if you do observe a change in neurologic status of the patient after the reduction, then you have to suspect some entrapment. This is a very uncommon evidence, but there are some reports in the literature, as the one as I put at the bottom of my slides. So keep in mind that if you have any change in neurologic status after reduction, this could be a sign of nerve entrapment. Most commonly is the ulnar nerve. The most serious one is about the median nerve, and the radial nerve is a rare evidence. And I just want to put these slides because I think it's an important paper, this one from Matev in JBJS America 1976. You have this radiological sign, which you can see on the slide. This is a small groove at the level of the medial condyle. And this is a sign that the medial nerve is entrapped into the joint. And of course, this radiological change tend to occur over time. It's not an acute pictures. So again, now we are moving, shifting towards the fracture. You have an associated fracture to the dislocation. You want to reduce the dislocation and stabilize the fracture with the surgery usually, because the elbow becomes unstable every time you have an associated fracture, mostly because of the severity of the injury. So what are the most frequently associated injuries? Are here, radial head, olecranon, coronoid process, very infrequent, and finally the medial epicondyle. And as I mentioned before, medial epicondyle fracture can be associated to elbow dislocation in up to 50% of cases. And here, as you can see in this slide, medial epicondyle fracture, elbow dislocation, the two lesions goes together. Now let's go precisely to discuss the features of the medial epicondyle fractures. So most of the time, this fracture is secondary to a traction exerted by the epicondylar muscles, because they do insert at the level of the medial epicondyle. However, if you look at the overall frequency of medial epicondyle fracture among all elbow fractures, the medial epicondyle fracture is not the most frequent, but is not so rare, because it represents about 20% of all elbow fractures. As I said, is associated to elbow dislocation very frequently, but most importantly, in about 20% of cases, the medial epicondyle can be incarcerated into the joint. Clinical examination is typical. You have pain, loss of function, swelling. Most of the swelling is at the level of the medial side, and you'd always have to test the ulnar nerve, sensation, fourth, fifth finger, and abduction, because you want to make sure that the ulnar nerve function is still preserved. Diagnosis is radiological. AP and lateral radiographs are enough to make the diagnosis. However, and we will see it later, maybe enough to measure the amount of displacement. Radiographic classification assess the amount of displacement. We have two big categories, the Watson-Jones classification and the anatomical classification, as I displayed, as I pointed out in this slide. There are four types, from the least severe to the most severe. And nothing more, you can read the slide easily. So here, type one fracture, undisplaced. Type two, when the displacement is limited, less than 2 millimeters usually. Type three, the fracture, the fragment is displaced and the fragment is into the joint. Sometimes it's difficult to assess where the fragment is, if it is really into the joint, whether it is into the joint or not. So the performing a CT scan can help you to detect the fragment into the joint and any other associated injury. However, remember, and this is a radiological sign which is quite important, if the medial epicondyle is at the level at the joint, as you can see in this slide, it means that the fragment is inside the joint. And it's really important for you when you are at the emergency department to be able to diagnose an incarceration of the fragment, because the fragment with an incarcerated fragment are those that have technically the poorest outcome. And here the type four, according to Watson-Jones, the fracture is associated with an elbow dislocation. So it was, as I was saying before, are really radiographs enough to make the diagnosis and to measure the amount of displacement? So if you want to make the diagnosis, just say this is a fracture of the medial epicondyle, radiographs are enough. However, if you want to be reliable and make measurements and assess the amount of displacement and even the direction of the displacement, it has been shown that radiographs are not enough. So if you want to have a clear appreciation of the amount and direction of the displacement, usually the CT scan is the best exam, although it is quite irradiating for this patient. And now also, otherwise, if you don't want to perform a CT scan and you want to have a better appreciation, you can do an oblique view radiographs, three-quarter radiographs, and this can give a more reliable approximation of the displacement. So what are the treatment options for this fracture? Two classical options, conservative and surgical treatment. Conservative is for non-displaced fracture. Again, elbow is flexed at 90 degrees for 3 to 4 weeks. And surgical is open reduction, key wire, or screw fixation. Again, elbow flexed at 90 degrees in a long arm cast for 3 to 4 weeks. What are the indications for surgery? Today, we consider absolute indication for surgery the incarceration of the fragment and the instability of the elbow, especially in athletes. Of course, surgery is indicated as well if you have ulnar and medial nerve dysfunction, maybe related to an entrapment. However, as I mentioned before, this is a quite rare event. What are the controversial issues? Some of the controversial issues. When should we operate this fracture? According to the displacement, 5 millimeters, 1 centimeter, more, less, and which kind of type of fixation should we use? Screw or key wires? We see that whatever type of fixation, you can achieve a similar functional outcome on the mid to long term. However, if you do use a fixation, you do perform a fixation with screw and washer, this could offer a more stable fixation compared to key wires, and thus allowing for earlier mobilization. Regarding the amount of displacement, I will discuss this point in a couple of minutes after going through some of the most relevant paper I found in the literature. The first one is this one from Josephson in Acta Orthopedica 1986. These authors assess 56 patients treated conservatively only, with a mean displacement of about 6 millimeters. These patients were followed up for 35 years, and they had a quite significant non-union rate, as expected. About half of the patients didn't achieve a final union. However, what they found, interestingly, is that all these patients had a good functional outcome at 35 years of follow-up. In this other paper from Heinz in Clinical Orthopedics 1987, they assess 31 patients with very tiny displacement, only 2 millimeters displacement, quite a shorter follow-up, only 4 years. But what they found is that surgical treatment yielded good results, and they could identify any difference between patients treated surgically compared to patients treated conservatively. And then if we go ahead and we look at this other paper from Wilson and colleagues in injury in 1988, they compared two groups of patients treated conservatively, 20 patients group one, against 23 patients treated surgically, group two. Here the displacement is a little bit higher, about 1 centimeters. Follow-up is the same. And what they found is that, interestingly, the non-union rate was slightly higher in patients treated surgically. However, patients that were treated conservatively, so no surgery, tended to have less symptoms, less pain, or less discomfort compared to patients treated surgically. And here, I think this is the key paper from Farsetti and colleagues in JBJS American 2001. These authors assess about 40 patients treated and divided them into three groups. One group were patients treated conservatively. Second group were patients treated surgically. Third group, a small group of patients treated by fragmenting excision. And in this article, the mean displacement was 10 millimeters. However, they included a patient with displacement up to 1.5 centimeters, and the follow-up was extremely long, 34 years. And when they checked the patient at last follow-up, they found that patient treated surgically and patient treated conservatively had a similar outcome for displacement ranging between 5 and 15 millimeters. And good outcome was also found in patients that didn't unite the fracture. So the only poor outcome was identified in patients treated by fragment incision with a good, with significant displacement. So the conclusion of this paper is that surgery and clinical and conservative treatment can provide a similar outcome. The worst outcome is in patients undergoing fragment excision, and thus fragment excision should always be avoided. However, patients that were treated conservatively tended to have more elbow instability on the long term compared to patients treated surgically. And this is a small article I did in 2017, just to point out once more that when you have an incarcerated fragment into the joint, this is a risk factor for a poor outcome. So when you look at the complication in this specific fracture, overall these are rare and are mostly related to failure of recognizing the incarceration of the fragment and a delayed treatment. So in conclusion, remember that elbow dislocation and medial epicondyle fracture goes together. Both injuries, and in particular medial epicondyle fracture, are source of instability. Conservative treatment, of course, carry a higher risk of displacement. However, the functional outcome on the mid to long term, whatever option you choose, is very similar. The goal of surgery is just one. This is an extra-articular fracture, so you want to perform a surgery because you want to have a stable elbow, especially if your patient is an athlete. And so far, there is no evidence that one treatment is much better than another. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Canavese. So, so Federico, don't you think that there is a big incoherence between what the literature says and what we do? I mean, most literature shows no difference between surgical and non-surgical treatment, but most of us talk about surgery and technique, and we still recommend surgery. What is your opinion? How you do manage your patients in your unit?
I think that it's just because it's a sort of in a natural history, the evolution of the medical treatment over time, because also the activities our children are doing nowadays are not the same compared to the activities they were doing 20, 30 or 40 years ago. Because today we have many children that are involved in throwing sports like baseball, American football, tennis, or whatever. And these activities require a stable elbow to be to perform well. So the indication for the surgery, the threshold for performing surgery has lowered down because you want to provide these children a stable elbow at the end so they can perform well and they can practice their sport up to the level they wish. Of course, if you are a cyclist, for example, and you don't use your upper extremities in your sports activity, you can live with an elbow that is less stable compared to an elbow of a tennis player. So this is my opinion. For me, the idea of performing treatment is related to the stability of the elbow as in connection with the activity the specific child is performing.
Let me ask some people in the audience. What is your indication for surgery in these fractures? Let's start with Dan Sotolov.
Federico, thank you for your talk. I completely agree with you. The treatment for medial epicondyle fracture is to treat the instability, not to treat the displacement or to treat anything, because if the elbow is stable, regardless of displacement, it's irrelevant, right? So we tend to, when we see a displaced fracture, it's very difficult to do an exam on instability. And I think and I'm thinking back to all the ones that we've seen failures of conservative management. And so I think that when you see these articles present these rosy pictures that conservative management always ends up with a good result, I don't think they're seeing the patients we're seeing. Because we see these patients afterwards and agreed, they're all, I think, Scott, it's true, they're all athletes. And when you have an athlete who requires a medial ligament complex, you have to at least assess the stability of the elbow. So we take these kids to the OR with a displaced fracture, and we will range them and stress their ligament under anesthesia. Just a quick puff of anesthesia. We do a valgus check. If the elbow is stable, we put them in a cast and we send them out, regardless of displacement. If the elbow is unstable, then we fix it, also regardless of displacement.
But then, what is instability? A complete dislocation or just the opening of the joint?
Just an opening of the joint.
Because I did several patients in which I did the gravity test.
Awake or asleep?
Asleep. So, that's what you call like gross instability. So they had gross instability, but I just put a cast, and I had in those 10 children, I had no problems afterwards.
So they were unstable under anesthesia and you left them with just a cast.
Yes, yes.
And these were athletes.
No athletes.
So that's the point.
I think
that's Federico's point, right? If you have a person who's going to sit on their couch, they're not going to really care.
But those clinically, I know that stability, you have to measure stability under anesthesia. But clinically, wait afterwards, months or years afterwards, the elbow was stable clinically.
Yeah, but it'll be stable clinically even in the acute displacement period.
So your recommendation is fixing in athletes.
Yeah.
So fixation.
I think Scott and I completely agree. And we've had this conversation also with Graham King, with Mark Cohen. You know, we tend to be the funnels of all the complications end up coming to us. And the complications may not be coming back to the centers that are writing these papers. And so I think that, you know, we see the bad outcomes as a concentrated stream. Right, Scott, do you have any comments on that?
No, I agree 100%. I think if they're unstable and they're an upper extremity athlete, they need to have it fixed. Because Paco, the other problem is they end up with an unstable elbow and the medial condyle is displaced down toward the joint. It's a difficult reconstruction. So you just can't pop it back on later. The ligament is shortened. So you're too far away from the origin and then you have to reconstruct the ligament. So I think it's a fairly simple operation done in the acute setting and a much more difficult operation done in the chronic setting.
Yeah, particularly if they're skeletally immature, it's very difficult to do a medial collateral ligament reconstruction because the place where you want to put the ligament is right around where the physis is. So it becomes very difficult. And I think the other issue we've had with our patients with non-unions is sometimes the non-union is so far down that it will block motion. And these kids will lose elbow motion. So it's not just that they have an unstable elbows, they also have unstable elbows with a loss of motion. And we've had more than one of those. I mean, I would say we've had at least five or six of those. Correct, Scott, with loss of motion?
Right. Yeah.
Sebastian, what are your indications for ECM fracture?
Well, actually, I mainly treat the post-traumatic cases. So due to the specialty referral center, I mainly see the cases which are unstable. And here I can just say, or I question how long they are supervised by the surgeons in the trauma centers, because lots of the children, or almost all children I see which had dislocations were dismissed very early after cast removal, non-operated cases. And then I see them, they like 1 or 2 years after the fracture and they are still painful and have an elbow instability. So I'm the same funnel type. I can say I see the unstable cases, but of course I just see the negative selection. So I don't see all the conservative cases which have gone well. So I'm a bit biased. But on the indication setting, I have not too much experience. But I just want to ask the panel, how long do you check the patients after the casting or cast removal? Because I think lots of ligament ruptures, and I know it's well known that there are lots of instabilities after the dislocations, but how long do you follow them?
Okay.
I think this is a crucial question also. How long are they followed? Because our traumatologists, they have like every time a child has something, they just tell you, oh no, it will heal from its own. So that's a problem in our country.
Thank you, Sebastian. And Dr. Takagi, what are your indications in your institution for ICM fracture?
Basically, we treated surgically because the fragment will be displaced after the surgery, a conservative treatment. So now we basically treat surgically.
Okay. Thank you, Takagi. So do you agree if we move to the next talk? Sí, vale. Thank you, Federico. Wonderful talk. Thank you.